Okay. Hello and welcome. This event is being recorded. Please switch off your cameras and use chat if you want to ask questions. If you don't want to be part of the recording, we will upload the offer recording onto our CDE YouTube channel later on. CDE is a growing movement of people in arts and culture declaring a climate and ecological emergency. We pledge to tell truths, take action, and seek justice. We believe that arts and culture can lead to creating a regenerative future that protects the planet and sustains everyone everywhere. So hello and welcome to this Culture Declares Emergency offer asking what on earth is going on? A roundtable discussion about the big issues facing the UK, 100 new licenses for oil and gas, a proposed ban on solar and fields, the investment zones and protective areas for nature, the energy crisis and the extreme growth agenda. We will explore the questions, what role can we in the culture sector play in supporting collaborations and other declarer initiatives responding to all this? How does this relate to COP27 and planned actions this autumn? And what can we do to respond effectively and rapidly to this situation to show the value of art? I'd like to welcome the speakers, the roundtable. And we also want definite involvement from all participants, and we're going to have some breakout rooms later. So first of all, I'd like to welcome Bridget McKenzie of Climate Museum UK, summarising current UK government perspectives on the Earth crisis.
Maybe just introduce everyone that's going to do the briefing.
I was 50-50 on that. Okay. I'd also like to welcome Dr. Asha Mintz of the Tyndall Centre who will be speaking on the current state of communicating climate science to publics. Jessica Townsend explaining why Writers Rebel are targeting 55 Tufton Street, and Chris Garrard from Culture Unstained on current issues with oil companies and their entanglements with culture. So I'd like to invite Bridget, please.
Yes, hello. And we should say as well that Ruth Bentoven was going to be here to share about the COP27 International Assembly, but I'll try and squeeze that bit into my briefing. So I'll just share my screen. So this event was my idea. So I'm sort of heading up with trying to do a summary of this god-awful and complex situation facing the UK right now, and try to understand what on earth is going on. And the earth bit is there so that we do actually have this ecological perspective to this situation. So I'm speaking here from the perspective of my role in Climate Museum UK, which really exists to try to kind of make sense of the situation and capture people's responses and to kind of capture and collect what's going on as the climate and ecological emergency happens. Obviously also to try to activate people to respond to it and you know, mitigate it and optimize our living, you know, to shift from a degenerative culture to a regenerative culture, to understand what's wrong and to imagine and build a more thrivable world. So this is a diagram that I've done to try to help people understand the Earth crisis. So we, although we're called Climate Museum UK, actually we're dealing with the wider Earth crisis. We try to explore and explain how climate sits within a wider set of breached planetary boundaries and how these create a wide range of impacts on lives, people, animals, the more than human world. So this diagram is based on an idea called carbon tunnel vision by Jan Konietzko, which is the idea that we focus so much on climate and carbon that we fail to see all of these wider factors. And it also limits us when we're thinking about solutions. So at the center here is the solution space, and we need to be thinking about, you know, reparative justice, how to help people adapt, about systemic inequalities and so on. So this is, you know, a very quick rundown of the entire Earth crisis. There's a huge amount more detail to add in there, but I hope that helps expand our perspective. So what about the UK government? You know, how are they seeing this expanded perspective? Well, in some ways they're not. You know, they're contributing to obfuscating this wider earth crisis, but they do have views about a lot of these things. So, you know, when I did this, they were focused on selecting a new prime minister. And, you know, personality and identity of leaders is so important for them. Energy sovereignty, you know, is really their blinkered view on the energy crisis. Growth, you know, is the kind of philosophy that's driving them. So, you know, all of these factors like breached planetary boundaries, you know, are interpreted here in more ecocidal ways, you know, with a mindset which is about exploiting, extracting, and not giving back and not regenerating nature. So, you know, and you can see around the outside this ring about the impact on lives. You know, their thinking is horrendously limited and antagonistic to life and justice, really. So, you know, this is the government that we currently have. And this is the situation that we're in. So in Culture Declares Emergency, we've declared a climate and an ecological emergency, which, you know, we've declared that it is an earth crisis. But just to focus on climate, you know, it's and I won't go into too much detail because Ash is going to talk more about this. But, you know, information is starting to reach us because of the build up to COP27. So there's a number of reports coming out. For example, the Lancet report came out today. You know, there's more and more information telling us that the UN is saying that we are heading, you know, for way beyond 1.5C. And, you know, that public support and concern is on the rise. Actually, there was a poll that said it wasn't, but in general, there is actually support for direct action and government action. Look at our record. The UK will overshoot its 2030 Paris Agreement emissions by 40%. So, you know, we need a climate and ecological emergency bill. But the government is defying climate warnings and it's proceeding with 100 new oil and gas licenses. And because it does, you know, the public is protesting, people are protesting, but rather than actually addressing people's concerns, they're worsening, they're tightening the public order bill, they're criminalizing protest. But just breaking news, Rishi Sunak has said he'll reinstate the fracking ban. So that's one tiny little bit of hope. And we mustn't forget the ecological emergency. And so the government have carried out what's called an attack on nature. So, you know, the wildlife and conservation bodies have come together to say we have to defend nature. So they've come up with campaigns like the one on the top right. The stripes on here, by the way, are biodiversity stripes, a bit like the climate stripes in the last slide here. So, you know, this is showing the increasing temperatures over time, and this shows the decline in biodiversity over time. And today we have a new Secretary of State for DEFRA, Therese Coffey, who's quite well known for tweeting about using Roundup with glee. So I don't know how I'm doing for time. I should speed up. This government is a populist government, and this is a list really of all the ways that governments control information and use media and culture. And I just wanted to post it here just as a reminder really of the power of culture to flip this and to, you know, to undermine the culture war, to, you know, where the government promotes this kind of global race between groups of people, we can subvert that. You know, there's so much that we can do to overcome this erasing of identities of the rights of diverse people. Anyway, this is something to do with the power of culture, and I'll stop sharing there. And I'll come back to the COP27 International Assembly before we go into the group discussion.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And now if I could pass over to Jessica, please.
Okay, thank you. Now, sadly, I don't have beautiful slides, but I do have a film for you at the end. So hold on. After watching my face for 5 minutes, there will be a diversion, I promise. So I'm from Writers Rebel, and Writers Rebel has, almost from the beginning, had a theme. That we're entering people who are denying. Can you hear me?
You might need to turn off your video so that we can hear you.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. So that began with an event outside Tufton Street at which Zadie Smith, George Monbiot, Jay Griffiths, and many other amazing writers spoke truth to power about what was going on in Tufton Street, in the shady, kind of hidden away place that is the Global Warming Policy Foundation, which is found at 55 Tufton Street. Now, even the name, the Global Warming Policy Foundation, is designed to be so dull that you that they can hide in plain sight. It sounds like something really technical and official, and that you could invest some trust in, almost like their accountants. But actually, they are in the middle of government, pushing against all measures to tackle fossil fuels and the way that our system is so dependent on fossil fuels and its funding. Anyway, as a result of that, we had a court case which was based on a little bit of criminal damage, and nothing seemed to happen in the world. With some culture makers were a little bit more informed, people in Extinction Rebellion knew a little bit about it, but we didn't really crack through. We have more recently taken a complaint to the Charity Commission, and that you can find that on the Writers Rebel website, on the Extinction Rebellion website, and that has a lot of names of great and good. It has three baronesses on it. It has Caroline Lucas, but it has many art practitioners as well. And we are waiting. We understand we're going to get a knockback, but they haven't officially come back. We have lawyers waiting, and we will be going in and saying that the fact that a climate denying organization is giving charity status is a kind of obscenity in our world, and we need to address it, even if in law and as far as the Charity Commission rules go, it doesn't make much sense. But it's a little bit like the Shell 7 being tried by jurors and saying this is the truth. In spite of the culture around this, we're speaking the truth, and eventually this will get heard. So as a mini campaign as part of this, and to keep pressure up, we have had six writers write personal letters to individual trustees of the Global Warming Policy Foundation. This followed Steve Baker leaving. Steve Baker, the hard man of Brexit, who also, of course, was incredibly instrumental in getting Liz Truss to take the role as the Prime Minister, which has been so very damaging for the country. When he got his ministry for Northern Ireland, he stepped down from the Global Warming Policy Foundation. So we said to the other trustees, do you really want your good name? Because the trust in trustee is quite key, that the charity uses your good name as a kind of foundation on which to stand. Do you really want to be associated with that? Toby Litt wrote a beautiful letter to Terence Mordaunt talking about the sea. Terence Mordaunt is somebody that's been associated with all things naval all of his life. We have a letter to Graham Stringer, who is the only Labour Party MP who is part of the Global Warming Policy Foundation, from Natasha Walter, herself a Labour, a Labour activist, saying, how can you be part of Labour and be part of the Global Warming Policy Foundation? It doesn't make sense to us. Anyway, check out the letters that on the Writers Rebel website. They're very beautiful items. We're waiting right now. We think that Zadie Smith is also going to do a letter for us. And when that one gets published, we're pretty sure that we'll be able to get some coverage in the press. Now, to introduce the film, as a kind of spin-off from the work we've been doing around denialism, we went into Steve Baker's constituency to try and combat his denialist work and say to his constituents, do you know that your MP is a climate denier? And that has been quite a strong, successful campaign, which we are now replicating in other constituencies. And one of those constituencies is North East Somerset. And I can hear it coming in, Jacob Rees-Mogg. So take it away.
To ask you what you thought about GEC in comparison with other electrical shares.
GEC very sound at the moment.
The money. I like the money.
That's what I want. That's what I want.
And with money you can make more money.
Allow fracking in your back garden in Somerset?
Yes, of course I would. I'd be delighted.
Would you?
Particularly if I get these royalties.
Let's get every square inch, cubic inch, get the measurement right, cubic inch of gas out of the North Sea.
Money, you can buy things that you want. I could buy this Rolls Royce, something like that. Lovely.
All right, thank you very much, Jessica. Could I pass on now, please, to Dr. Asha Minns. Thank you.
Hi, hello everyone, and very nice to talk to you, and thank you to Bridget for the invitation. So I'm Asha, and I'm Executive Director of the Tyndall Centre for Climate Change Research, which is a climate research organisation, as you might expect, and it comprises four universities in the UK, one in Shanghai, and I'm talking to you from Norwich. I'm based at the University of East Anglia. We're going to talk a little bit about the work we have done in really raising awareness of climate change, because, you know, I've been doing it for a long time, as have some people here, long before climate change got famous. And I think we can now say that climate change is famous. Most people have heard of climate change. We've got lots of polls and surveys that show all that, but that's been the same for the last decade or so. Most people are engaged with climate change. They have climate change or sustainability as a priority, but they don't necessarily, or most of us, not they, really know what to do and how to respond. And so my We've always had sort of artists and culture embedded in the Tyndall Centre. The Tyndall Centre is 22 years old, and we've had artists in residence since the beginning of the Tyndall Centre. I think partly in recognition that, you know, what we do, or what I do and my colleagues do, is we produce graphs and we produce text, and that never motivated anybody to do anything, really. Whereas you guys out there in culture, you do emotion. And we don't. So we have literally all the data in the world. Myself and my colleagues, we are weighed down with data on our shoulders. Possibly no more data is needed. We know what's happening, why it's happening, what's going to happen. But that's very different to knowing how to respond and engaging people emotionally with that. And so there's a quote I use from the American poet Maya Angelou, which is along the lines of people will always remember, people will forget what you said, what you did, but they will never forget how you make them feel. And that's the, you know, this is where the emotion comes in, because we have all the facts, all the data. And so what I do in my work is, or when I'm doing that bit of work, not running the Tyndall Centre, is the science of climate change communication. So this is a body of evidence that's growing from psychology, social science, communication sciences, decision sciences, about what works for engaging people, specifically here with climate change and sustainability. And the Tyndall Centre also has a sister centre now called CAST, which is Climate and Social Transitions, which is like the Tyndall Centre. It's a cross UK partnership, and it works entirely on behaviour change, barriers to pro-environmental behaviours, and to try and better understand that. So, I mean, one of the things that I think is true of climate change where climate change communication ends, in particular the work that I've done over the last 20 years, is our work was all about raising awareness. So climate change is happening. It's really important. There has to be responses, in what policy responses, industry responses, whatever they are. It falls down quite badly on what those responses are and getting those responses, but mostly we've done awareness raising, and I would like to think we've been hugely successful in that, because when I started, climate change was a nerdy topic for people hidden away in physics laboratories doing big mathematical computations about the climate system. They're still there, but they're allowed out a bit more. But you know, there's people doing lots more around climate than just solving math. A lot of the people in climate were because they were interested in the most difficult mathematical problems. Those have largely been solved. But there's a model that's used in marketing, it's used in communication, it's used in lots of places, called AIDA. So I thought I'd just talk to you about AIDA, and AIDA being AIDA, like the opera. And it's what stands for awareness, interest, desire, and action. So awareness is, who do you want to be conscious of climate change, or of your work, or thinking about the topic that you're trying to engage with? So that's the first bit. Then, are they interested? Is the second step? Do they know about climate, or whatever it is or sustainably what it is you're going to engage with them? But what new messages then do you have for them? What's a better way to engage them, to take them to the next step, which is desire messages? And desire is that important bit for lots of reasons. But desire is also where is that precursor to action. So do they realize the benefits, what it would do for them, what it might do for other people? And how can you engage them with that desire message? And so it's people pulling at wanting to take action, wanting to have a response to climate change. And then finally, you come with that action message, which is, are they already taking action? What could they do more or different? Or having stepped into the desire, what is it that they want to do next. And to go sort of very much away from what we're talking about here is sort of climate and sustainability, is that you is basically our purchasing decisions. This is used so much in marketing. So from advertising. So awareness is, first of all, have you heard of my product? Have you heard of Google? Have you heard of Zoom? You know, that's the first thing to market those products through to, wow, Zoom's pretty good. I think I might subscribe. I think I might actually start using it. And so there's a whole sort of psychological journey there that we can go on with people. And we're all on that journey ourselves, to go from that just raising awareness of an action through to people taking that action. So I just thought I'd sort of talk a little bit about the ADA model, and in particular, and it's a lot of it's about knowing your audience. And I think we're particularly bad in the sort of environment sustainability world of knowing our audience. We actually do a heck of a lot of talking to each other, you know, within the climate silo, bouncing around information between each other's. Whereas, of course, that's not overall what we're trying to do. It's about sort of wider society, politics, business, whoever your audience is. So I'm going to just, I'll finish on that topic of what it is we know about the science of climate change communication. Clearly, there's loads more than that. There's eons of work. I have a whole day's training idea on the science of climate change communication, but I will spare you that. But I did want to, because COP's coming up, and we're involved, the Tyndall Centre is always involved in COP. I've actually peak COPped. I've decided that Glasgow was my last COP. I've been to 20. So I'm not going to do any more. So I'm not going to Sharm El Sheikh, but my colleagues are. So I just thought, just like Bridget there actually was talking about the Lancet countdown came out. So I just thought I'd just show or just tell you about some things that are coming out that you might like to look out for, given your interest in the fact that you've come to this discussion. So Climate Action Tracker will show where all the countries are on their emissions targets and their emissions pledges. That's one. The World Resources Institute will do State of the Climate. UNEP actually has two reports. Two reports coming out. There's the Emissions Gap Report, which is the difference between, again, a bit like Climate Tracker, the pledges and what the and emissions going up and pledges supposed to be bringing emissions down. World Energy Outlook, Lancet Countdown we did. The UNFCCC, the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, will be doing mapping 1.5 degrees. We had a little bit of discussion. Oh, no, Bridget showed a slide about 1.5 degrees. The IPCC earlier this year, or was it last year, in the sixth assessment says there's 20 years to 1.5 degrees. And then we will also be publishing, in the Tyndall Centre's part of this work, the global carbon budget, which similarly shows exponentially, usually emissions rising versus where emissions are going down to. So IPCC says 20 years to 1.5 degrees, and we've got emissions going up every year pretty much, unless there's COVID or a big economic downturn. So on that note of doom, yeah. I will finish.
Thank you, Asha. Thank you so much. And can I now pass on to Chris Garrard, please?
Sure, thank you. I have some slides here. Because also I'm sat in the dark and the slides probably look better than my face. Oh, I've started at the end, so it's kind of like reading the end of a good book. That's probably overselling what I'm about to say. Anyway, so my name is Chris Garrard. I'm the co-director of Culture Unstained. We've been in existence since 2015, campaigning against fossil fuel sponsorship of culture and cultural institutions, and as part of a wider network of groups, not just in the UK, but internationally as well. I think there's probably quite a few people on this call who already know quite a lot about this subject as well, but I hope the things I'm going to say are kind of useful, and I just wanted to maybe make a few connections. So this is a slide that I often include just to give a flavour of what it is that we're campaigning against in when we talk about fossil fuel sponsorship of culture. I've included in here examples of sport as well, which is coming to the fore, particularly with Shell sponsoring British cycling, but also particularly in Australia right now, we're seeing a lot of pushback against sponsorship of sport. But I just kind of showed this slide because it demonstrates the kind of entanglement and the embedded nature of how the fossil fuel industry's brands are just interwoven into these spaces and normalised. That's the kind of public-facing piece, but a lot of the research that we do is that behind these logos, behind this branding, there are the VIP launches, the receptions, the openings where policymakers, decision makers meet for these interactions. BP love to go to the Royal Opera House for a drink with a policymaker. They also like to sponsor events in Russia in the past as well to do exactly that kind of thing. So it's very much attaching themselves to cultural diplomacy. The really exciting thing, and hopefully kind of picking up from what Asha was just saying, is that there's a lot of vibrancy and creativity in the activism forms that have challenged these sponsorship deals over the years. This is a rapidly pulled together few images just to give a flavour of that, the kind of variety. And there are many, many, many more and many other groups and they're sort of out there. But I show these ones just to show the variety, the different forms they can take and the different kinds of people and groups that have gotten involved in them. The exciting impact of it is within the last few years, we've seen these kind of dominoes start to fall. And what's exciting is on the South Bank, in particular, these partnerships with Shell. So Shell's headquarters, now its kind of main headquarters, are on the South Bank in London. But the cultural institutions that were built around the same time on this complex have all ended their corporate partnerships with Shell now. And we saw an equivalent thing kind of happen in Amsterdam as well, this kind of collective shunning of Shell as a corporate partner. And then at the start of this year, BP once again being shunned by the National Portrait Gallery and the Scottish Ballet, both around the same time. And when we think about, I guess, like campaign strategy and how we get people to like rethink these things, these kind of headlines allow us to try and craft different narratives, I suppose, around us kind of breaking away from fossil fuels being embedded in our daily lives and cultural activity. But going on from these forms of activism, I've juxtaposed these two images, and I think there's strength and discussion to have around both of the protests in here. So probably people are more familiar with the top one, but the bottom one happened several years ago when members of Reclaim the Power and BP on LPP and so on protested against Shell sponsoring the National Gallery at that time. That partnership is now over. But at the same time, showing solidarity with the PCS union members at the National Gallery whose jobs were about to be privatised. So the claim of the National Gallery, oh, we need this money from a dirty oil company, but, well, we're not actually even going to distribute that sponsorship money in a fair and even way that guarantees good conditions for our workers. And I guess one of the things I'm highlighting or sort of suggesting behind this is the importance of solidarity, and that's kind of the point I want to come on to now is, behind any creative intervention or point where we break through, make contact, engage people and speak to a wider audience, what are the ways we're following up, building bridges, making new connections and relationships that allow us to go a bit deeper? It's one thing to confront the superficial kind of glitz of the advertising of the fossil fuel company, but what we have the power to follow it up with is something deeper, a little bit more systemic, a little bit more built in the relationships of our organising. And this is not the, this is just the most recent example I have of this, which we undertook with Culture Unstained. So the British Museum just a couple of weeks ago opened a new exhibition on Egypt, just a few weeks before COP27 is about to happen. In fact, it was opened by the ambassador to the UK, the Egyptian ambassador to the UK. And the BP branding is much, much smaller, and our campaigning that we did highlight BP, but Allah, who's referred to here, Allah Abdel al-Fattah, is one of the most prominent political prisoners in Egypt currently. There are tens of thousands of political prisoners who have been imprisoned under President Sisi's repressive laws in the country. And so we took a decision that, yes, the BP, as I'll come on to, the BP sponsorship is really relevant, but actually we wanted to show solidarity to those political prisoners ahead of COP and with Alice's family. And the problem with this exhibition, in some respects, is that it's allowing the Egyptian government to also present a progressive green image on the world stage, much as COP27 is allowing it to do, and in a way that we see a parallel with BP trying to constantly greenwash its image and claim it's doing the right thing. But again, we put together a letter with various prominent people to the director of the museum saying, take a stance on this issue and see the way it's connected to BP. And this is an example of that. So one of the things we talk about a lot within the climate movement is new exploration. But thanks to this kind of International Energy Agency report saying we can have no new investment in oil, gas and coal. But we sort of often gets quite abstract. And now we've got the example of the North Sea licenses that make it concrete. But actually, where are the other places that's happening? And a kind of key place of new exploration for BP is in Egypt. It supplies or is responsible for about 60% of Egypt's fossil gas extraction. But the picture at the top was the burgeoning climate movement in Egypt. This was in a town called Idku, where BP was expanding its gas processing plant, and the community successfully opposed BP, and it was defeated and had to be located elsewhere until President Sisi brought in repressive anti-protest laws and shut down the opposition. And so BP, although they wouldn't admit it publicly, have directly been aided by the repression of those human rights. And so what are the ways in which we, through our actions here, the spaces where there's the shopfront for fossil fuel companies here, can be joining the dots? What are the ways that we can connect BP's new exploration or new oil licenses in the North Sea, potentially, with what's happening in Egypt as well? And what is our responsibility as a movement ahead of COP27? Not to get so embroiled in the policy conversation that we also lose sight of the human rights piece as well. So how can we do both? How can we make the narrative more complex and deeper?
Chris, could I give you one more minute, please?
Yes. And this is just to give another quick flavour of that, which is this is the Science Museum as well. And we see a similar pattern playing out here. So this is the Prime Minister meeting Gautam Adani, the director of Adani, which is a major coal miner and producer. And they met at an event at the Science Museum, which has now signed a sponsorship deal with the Science Museum as well. And so when we're talking about these kind of sponsorship relationships, which we see here, this kind of mirroring of the government policy making, lobbying, the policy on the world stage, all of these things are interrelated, intersected, and the kind of creative tools that we have are very effective at starting to challenge and push back at them. The point I just want to conclude on is just to say that right now, Alaa's sister is conducting a sit-in outside the Foreign Office in London up to the beginning of COP. So if you are in London at all and able to go and show support or solidarity, it would be very welcome as well. So I'll just finish there. Sorry, I overran.
No, that's great. Thanks, really interesting. Thank you, Chris. So really now we just have a few minutes just to invite more insights and bits of news, links that everyone here wants to share. If you have like just one sentence or two sentence pointers, please, and just raise your hand if you've got something to
could share. I just go first, Jamie?
Yeah,
just please. I'm sorry, I have already spoken, but because I just need to cover what Ruth would have shared had she been here, but she's unwell. So Ruth Benthoven was going to talk about the Culture COP International Assembly. So I'm just going to share the link to it here. It's on the 31st of October. It's online, but some of the elements, sorry, I've just realised my volume is low. Some of the elements will be shared to the in-person Culture COP that's happening, that Farana Yamin is hosting. But on the 31st of October, this event it's a collaboration between Culture Declares Emergency and a number of other organisations, including Julie's Bicycle, the Black and Indigenous Liberation Movement, and many others. And it's a participatory event, so it's not just a sort of drop in to listen to a whole lot of of talks, but it is free and the link to join is there. And I think all of the things that Ruth was going to say are actually answered in the blurb that's there too. And the other quick thing I want to say is Polly asked about links being shared, and I have prepared a collection of links here. It's not comprehensive and it doesn't include links that Chris talked about or every single link that Asha talked about, but it's a collection of current news, environmental political issues, initiatives, reports, and this is an invitation to everyone here to add more, including cultural initiatives that are responding to this situation. So it's open access, you can edit it, but please don't edit everything, just add. So yeah, they're my two bits to share.
Has anyone else got any insights or news that they want to share? Yes, Leslie.
Well, I want to tell you more than one sentence because it's about the Festival of Resistance, which we held outside the Tate Gallery. And that was postponed, of course, from Hyde Park. So we had 3 weeks to squeeze one day of events in. And we are intending to repeat this kind of pattern because it was highly successful. Now, what we're trying to do is to get hold of popular culture, people who are draws for people outside the movement. So for instance, we had Lily Cole, who was very good. And we had Kate Raworth, and they both get on. We had a number of Black speakers and performers. And we had, of course, Writers Rebel. We had Disraeli. She Drew the Gun. This kind of eclectic approach. So if anybody is interested in what we're doing, because we are a group of programmers now, and we intend to take forward what we're doing and hopefully produce a kind of local festival in Lewisham next year, you can contact me, but I don't guarantee that you're going on the stage or anything like that, because what we're trying to do is to get people on there that people outside the movement recognize, know, and will come and listen to.
Thank you, Leslie. And if you want later on to put that, any contact details and information about that in the chat, that'd be great after our breakout room. We've got another minute or so. Has anyone else got any points they wanted to raise or any issues or informational things that anything that's come to your mind at all? No? Okay. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to create breakout rooms. I've seen a YouTube tutorial about how to do this. So you're in safe hands. I haven't done this before. Everything will be fine. And I believe it's going to be 30 minutes. And we're going to...
I'm going to put 20 minutes.
I've put into chat the question that we wanted you to consider, please. What role can we in the cultural sector play in supporting collaborations and other declare initiatives responding to all this, to respond effectively and rapidly to this situation to show the value of art? So if you cut and paste that, if that would be great, or make a note of that, that would be lovely. I'm now going to start the rooms. We have 4 groups, so we're all back. We should all be back because I closed all the groups. So yeah, we have 4 groups. Bridget, would you like to start off?
Yes, okay. Fine. So first of all, we talked about whether or not it's possible to prove that art makes a difference. But then we broadened out to think about all of the ways that the arts, when properly valued and embedded into society, enable more connectivity, more cooperation, more well-being, and in that broader way, it does have value, and we mustn't worry too much that it doesn't. what we ended up really talking about was this loop of constraint and uncertainty that affects cultural organizations, where, so, you know, the right wing is getting more radical, so the protests get more radical, the cultural organizations are getting more scared about supporting activism or being seen to be political. There's a threat of even more austerity. Both Labour and Tory are currently supporting the criminalisation of protest. So, you know, what we need, then Agatha in the group suggested, we need some kind of positive message and some kind of flipping of this loop of death. And then we moved on to talking about the Alliance of Declarers. So this is the Declarers initiatives that have been coming together to discuss how we might act together. And we talked a lot about Just Stop Oil and the, you know, the value of the kind of protest that takes place in cultural spaces, value or not. And I ended up by saying that I really think that one message we can strongly convey is the Fossil Fuel Non-Proliferation Treaty, because that is a more structured, organized and justice focused way of saying just stop oil. And, you know, it includes reparations and work towards a just transition for fossil fuel workers and so on. So I just think that that's something that Declarer initiatives can support. So that was me coming up with a strong message at the end there, but there's probably more to say, but I hope that's enough as a feedback. Mm-hmm.
Could you put that link to that fossil fuel?
Yes, I
will. That would be lovely.
I'll make.
Thank you. Who else would like to, was in another group, would like to feedback? I didn't ask people to designate feedbackers. Apologies for that.
I nominate Polly because she made me think very hard.
We started off talking about how culture can help connect these disparate issues, particularly around the social justice. So thinking about what Chris had been saying about supporting the movement around Allah, and how that can be a very positive thing to try and break down these barriers between things which actually aren't disconnected at all. They're just put in different boxes. We then talked about, I had asked Asha which of the artists they'd worked with at the Tyndall Centre had maybe been most effective at cutting through. So we talked quite a lot about that, and some of them had been works that sort of started with sort of where people were, maybe in slightly softer places like gardens or swimming pools or things that people could relate to, rather than coming straight in with maybe harder edge messages. But that also led to a conversation of, is that where we need to be? And is that too slow, or does it not get to where we need people to get to quick enough? Do we need a more direct approach? And that's what we were sort of talking about towards the end, is there a place for both? That sometimes you do need to start where people are. Other times you need to maybe use different methods and come in at a more direct way. So we didn't resolve that one, but we just kind of acknowledged that sometimes that it maybe depends on who it is you're trying to reach and where they are along a continuum. Because you probably we do need to connect with grassroots, but we do also need to make impact on the people who can make decisions that are going to have a bigger impact on the issue, if that makes sense. Does that kind of cover it okay, Tim and Asher and Jeff?
And which I may, which to me in my mind, anyway, comes back to this ADA model I was talking about, from awareness, interest, desire, action. What response is it you're trying to elicit, provoke in the person, and so thinking backwards from that. We didn't discuss that. I just sort of chucked that in just now.
Thank you. I'm interested, Chris, what group were you in? Or is there someone else in the group you were in? Have you?
I was with Leslie, Harriet, Rob, and April.
Would you like to hear back from anyone in that group? Well, Chris, if you start your feedback and then I was going to flip in, is that okay?
Yeah, we'll do it. I wonder if someone else might like to feedback instead of me, as I've spoken already.
We just wandered around the houses, really. We didn't really hit upon anything specific. We just talked about us, you know, what we do as artists, as a group, and then I don't know, really.
We looked at, you know, what's political with a big P, political with a small P, and similar to what was just said, that small actions in the places where people live can make a difference, and there's different levels of activism. And then we did talk quite a lot about Just Stop Oil and more direct action and how people communicate. And Leslie's part of that, you'll know a lot about that, but the younger people and the older people, but not those in between who have jobs or are employed and find it more difficult to do that kind of protest work. So we looked at how do you get to the people who are running the system, and how do you get to the people that aren't running the system but still need to have awareness raised and feel empowered that they can make a difference? Because if everybody thinks they can't, then that's not great. April talked about fugitive ways of, you might want to say something about that, April, and the power of music, and not always being too precious about art, I think, and letting it filter in lots of different ways. So yeah, like Rob said, we went around the houses because there's no one answer, is there?
Thank you. I wonder, Polly, if you could just talk a bit about, you were talking about intergenerational work, or expand a little bit on that in our group.
Yeah, I was just saying, because today we hosted about 14 socially engaged artists in Toxteth in Liverpool. And I feel like there's some local artists here in their 60s and 70s who have really like strong eco art experience and have been activists their whole lives. And I don't feel there's a lot of channels for like sharing those kind of experiences with younger artists who are really keen and have their own kind of socially engaged groups, but don't always have that kind of confidence that potentially that intergenerational connection could spark. Like certainly with Jamie Reed locally here, who is part of Visual Stress, they did a lot, and I've met groups in Glasgow who demonstrated against the M77. Galgale's an amazing example, and I just feel like sometimes the younger artists are entering the field with questions and they're not always finding the roots to some of these more confident activist artists kind of thing.
Cool. Has anyone else got any other points or questions or ideas that came about these conversations? Okay. Was that someone who wants us to say something? No, I think
we're. Hear me.
Carry on. Yeah.
Is it?
Oh, April. Yeah. Oh, switch. Try switching off your. Try switching off your camera and tell us. Okay. Yeah. I think April, we're struggling. Do you want to put it in chat? What you're going to say in chat, and we'll look at it there. Sorry. And in the meantime, can I ask Polly to just talk about your project, please? The Northern Flower House project, which we had sort of scheduled in to hear about as well. So that'd be really good.
Yeah, I'll share some images later, but this came about because I got involved in the National Wildflower Centre, and we did a 3-year project with Kew Gardens, instigated by artist Rebecca Chesney, and we had the best views over the Mersey, this big urban meadow, and we linked with Hume in Manchester The wildflowers that were sown in 3 months that come out in big annual meadows, and now we've got perennial meadows which are about 8 to 12 years old, but the annual meadows been adding to each year. So now we've got 35, 40 individual sites in Liverpool, about 72 different, some of them are verges rather than meadows. But the idea is to link up across the north around infrastructure routes, and to also, because we machine harvest and hand harvest the seed, is to create circular economy with the seed. And we find it really interesting because where there's been contested sites like Rimrose Valley at the moment against the roads, where sites have almost been built on, but community groups have gone against them, the wildflower meadows are really regarded in a different way. And we feel with some of the communities in Liverpool, where people have been displaced from the land, and that reconnection with the land, like it's been quite powerful. So it comes back to that thing which Polly was saying about on your doorstep, because we can work, like we did a charter for the British Soil Association conference with Jamie Reed, which is trying to stop topsoil new developments and all this. We've done charter with the Kissing twins. We've got like the ecological principles to try and underpin the work that we're doing, the work, the flowers that people see. And I think it can sort of become a movement, but I think it's trying to get across those ecological principles in a way that has a bit of an impact on the way that people and communities think about new developments, that is something that could go a lot further, and probably we could be quite a lot bolder in terms of how we put that across. But the idea of Scouse Flower House being part of Northern Flower House is really to create this kind of movement and exchanges of seed locally. So that's something I've been involved in now since 2014, and I hope that there can be some exchange and way in which that can link in somehow. Certainly some of the visuals we've got are good, and music does play a brilliant role in terms of always having live music when we do the sewings and stuff.
Polly, you mentioned in our breakout about the relationship between migration and land and the port city with diasporas and so on. Would you like to expand a little bit more about that, about the relationship, the importance of land-based projects to people who have moved to new lands? Is that something that you wanted to expand a bit on?
Well, yeah, and it also is about economic models, because, you know, that Eleanor Ostrom was an economist. She talked very much about distributive economics and how groups working closer to the land that know their patch of land should have more control over the economics. And I think what we're trying to do is like have community group school associated with land and keep telling the young people it's your land, this is your land to do. But it's also responding, so where different cultural uses of stuff like fat hen, different people who are naturally like gravitating towards the wildflowers for different reasons, trying to keep learning on that, to keep evolving the way that we're communicating about it. But I do feel like with the way that people were violently displaced, whether it's the Irish potato famine or whether other groups in Liverpool, there is a need to sort of reach out very much on their terms locally to be able to create this movement. We've had like football podcasts this year that have gone to like a lot of Liverpool fans. We've had like various people who've got on board with the project, like the Hillsborough project, because it has a cultural resonance for the city. But I don't know, it's just constantly being able to respond in ways which make sense to different groups. And we should, of course, have a lot more investment in jobs, in green jobs, working with wildflowers. And that's where we need to get to, which we haven't got at the moment. But there's certainly a lot of positive responses and symbolism attached to it and memory in that.
Thank you. April's put something into chat, pointing us in the direction of someone to look at. So, yeah, and Bridget's mention that as well. So I just want to ask you, Asha, if I may, about your awareness, interest, desire and action, and that methodology of practice, and how that relates to your climate science colleagues and how they might respond to engaging on projects with artists or who are taking that sort of way of working. I mean, what's your experience of that?
Yeah, I think absolutely. I've always been pushing on an open door when we've done arts engagement. Absolutely. I have I have a particular interest, which is not engaging with what I call the usual suspects. So that would be the same whether it was for climate change. So I used to do much more communication than I do now as a director. But you know, nobody cares if I get the Tyndall Centre in the Guardian, because it's been read by all the environmentalists anyway. Nobody would just say anything to me at all, actually. However, you know, if you get into the Mail on Sunday, or often because somebody's broken into our emails, but or a paper that's read by others who are not the usual suspects, then that has more value. And I would sort of say the same for some of our arts work. Actually, some of our arts work has probably been a bit safe. It's been with artists in galleries. That's not entirely true, because I won't actually use galleries. I always insist on having to have a public place as well, something more than that. But it started off quite safe, and maybe I've learned a bit. So I think arts, so my colleagues absolutely up for collaborations, as am I, the Tyndall Centre. But I would like it always to be art that engages with not the usual suspects. So it isn't just engaging with other environmentalists who turn out to see an exhibition about climate change. If we don't mention climate change at all, that's a win, I think. I think that would probably be where I would be most interested in, is reaching and engaging with other people who aren't the usual suspects for climate, whether that be environmentalists or the type of people who would come, or kind of established art people who have comfortably opened the door of a gallery and stroll into a gallery. I find art galleries very strange places. They're not my natural habitat. We're always open for all ideas for sure, and always happy to talk things through as well. I have a theory, which is when you present science to the Arts Council, they often like to fund stuff, because I don't think that they get very much of it. So there's something for those of you who are artists and looking for arts funding. That's something to think about, I think. I mean, I'm aware that lots of artists don't make it through the funding process, don't always make it through the research funding process. But in my limited experience, when you put some climate and science into an arts funding, it so far has always got funded. Of course, I might be wrong in the next one.
Has anyone else got any other questions or points they wanted to raise? Because there's one thing that I probably wanted to just raise to both Chris and Asha, just as speakers. The kind of, you mentioned, Asha, about the role of emotions and feelings. What would you say to colleagues or that you work with who don't value, who struggle to see how that would make a difference? Say, for instance, like activists who have been working on for a long time, trying to work in really difficult situations, and then artists come along and start to talk about kind of using ways to have an embodied response to change people, the way people look at things. And also sort of scientists as well. You know, have you found there's been some pushback with that sort of that way of working, Chris, first of all?
It's a rich question, so I'm just having to try and think about how best to respond to it. I guess the kinds of art making that we've been connected to have been the ones in cultural spaces. So in terms of that kind of pushback and maybe how it connects to some of the points that Asha was just making. We would do creative interventions in the British Museum, for example, and then some of the pushback being like, who are the people making those interventions? What are the issues that they're centering in it? And the kind of challenge of the British Museum matters to a particular demographic of people. And there were people saying, you've got young people in the suburbs of London who never go to the British Museum. So what does it mean to them? And that's not necessarily to say that it's no longer a legitimate place to scrutinise or target or hold to account, but for us to dig a bit deeper into the intersections. And I think there was a shift, particularly with the group BP or not BP, in how some of the creative actions were thought about. Like, who were the collaborators? So it wasn't just who are we trying to engage with, it was who are the people designing the interventions or the art making that's going to happen in those spaces? And then what are the other issues that we're connecting to the sponsorship issue? What Ash was speaking to just now made me think of, I know various people here were involved in it, but the work of the Horniman around air pollution and those things where we're kind of not taking climate change just in the abstract, but into the specific issues that relate to people in their particular communities and making it relevant to them. And I think there's quite powerful opportunities for the creative activism in those contexts. I think sometimes there was a kind of pushback if we'd not really thought in a more kind of deeper or textured way about how we were challenging power through the ways that we were creating together, or challenging ourselves about who we might work with or how we might organise, or whether we give away the power and we book the room, the space, the event, and allow other people to do the creative making, and we're there to resource and support it, and just changing all of that.
Okay, thanks, Chris. And it's time now to leave up. Do reach out to Culture Declares Emergence if you haven't already declared, and come and join us. You'll be very welcome. And I'd like to thank all the speakers and all the contributors and everyone here. Thank you very much. We'll put it up on the YouTube channel. See you all soon, hopefully. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Jamie. Thanks, everyone.